allow for that to happen anymore. I can't conduct electricity to power the battery and motor properly. I know where the issue is. I just need to get down there and clean it, retighten it, and recover it. It's been too cold, been too wet. Expected. Yeah, this kind of traffic. But I did. Accident, looks like they just pulled over for some reason. I don't know why. But I noticed it too late, so I can't pull over to help. Plus, they're on the other side of the road, and I don't like crossing traffic even when we're at this much of a slow rate of speed. So, you know, it seems like it's slow to me. We're still doing about 30. And I don't know about you, but I cannot sprint across two lanes of traffic doing 60 to make that run safely right there. Sure, truck. Sure. I will see. slow down just enough to let you do. So, you keep the moment. Kind of weather, last thing I want to be stuck between two semi trucks in case one is not paying too much attention and something happens. You know what happens to me in between that? Squished. Death. Nothing left. Well, there'll be a lot left, but it'd be kind of spread all over the roadway. And I don't know if you've ever seen a Cannibal Corpse album cover, it would look a lot like that.
Emergency. Not by mind, but this is the wall itself allows they're going to use it. And that's where the business sense really takes over for the cartels. That's part of their business model. I think another important point people don't understand is once you clear the ports of entry, you are very, very close to accessing interstate and large highway systems. So it allows them to move the dope on down the road.
So you would like to take those few $1 billion and do what instead? Would you improve scanning technology at legal ports of entry so that more than a small percentage, a relatively small percentage, gets scanned?
Yeah, absolutely. I would increase manpower and technology all along the border. I think that's really important as we look to the future because you need to understand the cartels themselves. Now, law enforcement obviously has limited resources and we have to play by the rules. The cartels have unlimited resources and they simply make up the rules.
You know, we spoke the other day on this program with the police chief of Tucson, Arizona, and he made it clear that his real concern was not drug interdiction, not that it was pointless, but he was actually worried about drug addiction. He was worried about cutting off the demand for drugs rather than worrying so much about the supply.
Yeah, I think it's a good point. You know what a real national emergency is? It's 120 some odd people each day in this United States dying of drug overdose, and much of that is opioid related. It's estimated now that nearly 70,000 of our citizens will lose their life because of drug abuse. That's a national emergency.
Is a wall going to save any of those lives?
Well, certainly a wall would slow down, I think, illegal immigration migration from aliens, but it will have little effect on the large amount of narcotics that are coming into the country.
You are suggesting, I think, that the whole discussion of drug traffic is a diversion. This is really about attempting to stop people.
I believe it is. And for the life of me, I just don't understand why the administration doesn't listen to the experts who have been doing this a very, very long time and can provide the right advice and still get the job done.
Do you believe that the things you're saying to me about the relative uselessness of a wall, that's a mainstream law enforcement view?
I certainly think for when you look at the resources available to DEA and other agencies, we're about 500-600 agents down of our authorized strength. I think money could be well spent. And then look at the treatment and education issue to back up really the national issue.
No, authorized strength, that is the number of agents that you can legally hire if Congress then gives you the money, but Congress has come up short on the money.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Roddy, thanks so much. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Former Deputy Drug Enforcement Administrator Jack Riley. He's also author of the new book, Drug Warrior, Inside the Hunt for El Chapo and the Rise of America's Opioid Services.
Gilroy, California calls itself the garlic capital of the world. And two policies of the Trump administration, one on trade, the other on immigration, are having mixed effects on this agricultural community. NPR's Jasmine Garst visited the town caught in the middle.
It's about 50 degrees outside, but for a moment, it looks like it's snowing. The morning air is pungent, savory, and those flakes falling from the sky are garlic skin pieces, drifting away from the peeling facility I'm standing outside of. I'm in Gilroy, south of San Francisco, at the Christopher Ranch, the largest garlic producer in the country. Ken Christopher, executive vice president, tells me it didn't always look this busy. In the 1990s, he says the industry was hit hard by cheap Chinese garlic imports.
The U.S. garlic was trading around
Christopher Ranch was the biggest. Christopher says about 6% of its garlic is bought from China. The rest is homegrown.
It was really hard. You know, we're talking reduction in workforce, we're talking reduction in work hours. We had furlough days just simply to get through the year.
This struggle went on for years. Then in 2016, Donald Trump was elected president, and his stance on Chinese imports was pretty clear. Tax them.
We are now making it clear to China that after years of targeting our industries and stealing our intellectual property, the theft of American jobs and wealth has come to an end.
Christopher flew out to Washington last year to testify in favor of tariffs on Chinese garlic. That would mean Chinese garlic at your supermarket would be way more expensive than American grown. When he talks about tariffs, Christopher's face lights up. He says his dream tax on Chinese garlic is over 400%. Steve even had to pull garlic from storage to meet increased demand. But like most American agriculture, a lot of this town's labor force is immigrant. And the Trump administration's crackdown on undocumented labor has hit many California farmers hard. Christopher says he thinks about this all the time.
If the Republican Party is pro-business, if they want to support industries across the country, they need to realize that immigration is a critical function of that.
Driving through downtown Gilroy, it's clear this town has close ties to Mexico. The streets are lined with taquerias, discotecas, and there are sites in the outskirts that house migrant workers.
Just in general, there has been a lot more fear. Just fear to be out in public.
I'm with Gerardo Barba, an outreach coordinator for Catholic Charities. He says the mood here has changed.
We started noticing changes recently with the higher amounts of actual arrests that ICE conducts, generally going to people's homes, knocking on the door.
At the Gilroy Catholic Charities office, I meet a man who packages garlic at the Christopher Ranch. He says they're great bosses. He gets paid $15 an hour, a solid wage for a farm worker. He recently got his green card, and yet... He asked that his name not be used because he has family members who are undocumented and worried about getting deported. If that happens, they've asked him to take care of their children. He says even though business is booming, there's a lot of fear, and he wonders. If enough people get deported, who's going to harvest all that garlic? Jasmine Garz, NPR News, Gilroy, California.
We're going to look at how CVS Health tries to reinvent itself. The company is trying to make its stores health hubs, the same stores many people pop into to buy toiletries and junk food. To hear that story and more, just ask your smart speaker to play NPR or your member station by name. Just tell your smart speaker to play 89.3 WFPL and you'll hear that story this afternoon.
Overall, that ride wasn't that bad today. Of course, if I ever take 65, 264, that route is notoriously horrendous in any kind of weather. I've seen cars do 900s in the snow, grab the wall. Rain. Flip.
Which automatically builds, monitors, and rebalances portfolios.
It is now 7:20. Definitely about that time. for me to say. Goodbye.